Hello and welcome to ACP's Inside Look series with Home Depot. I'm Rich Comitz, Senior Vice President, Chief of Staff here, and I'm pleased to be speaking with our guests from Home Depot as we talk a little bit about a exciting new tool that they have called Mission Transition. For those of you who don't know, Home Depot is the largest home improvement retailer in the U.S. They have thousands of locations throughout the country and have an excellent reputation in the military community. I'm excited to learn a little bit more about their new program called Mission Transition. And I want to make sure I remind everybody that we are going to allow for questions at the end of the broadcast. So please go ahead and put them in the chat. And also the session will remain on our LinkedIn and be placed on our website. So if you want to watch it again or share it with your friends, please do. So today I wanted to introduce our guests real quick. We have Gabe, Pete, and Erik. We're going to hear a little bit more from Pete and Erik a little bit later on in the broadcast. But I'm going to turn it over to Gabe so he can tell us a little bit more about just some of the things going on at Home Depot and a little bit more on Mission Transition. So Gabe, over to you.
Thanks, Rich, and thanks to ACP for hosting this event. You guys do a great job, and we always appreciate coming to talk to you guys. Now, I'm an ACP protege alum myself, so it's an organization that is near and dear to my heart because I think the work you do actually makes a big difference. And within the Home Depot, we are proud to have over 30,000 veterans and military spouses as part of our workforce. So we know that we have a reputation as a military-friendly employer. We want to maintain and build upon that reputation because we know the competition for veteran talent out there is fierce. Now, this latest tool is one that we hope will continue that solid relationship that we've enjoyed with the military community. And it's called Mission Transition. So Mission Transition is a series of free online courses available at our military hiring portal that helps veterans and others transitioning from service to work on the fundamentals. It's like the blocking and tackling of getting ready for that next position. We focus on items like building your resume, making sure you have your right interviewing skills, and also importantly, branding and networking. These are skills that maybe while we were in the military, we didn't quite worry about so much, at least not to, you know, other potential employers. We did worry about how it affected us within the organization. But I think anybody who's transitioning knows that it's a completely different ballgame. And these courses walk you through making sure that your branding and networking is as strong as it can be. It helps you build that great resume to translate your skills in the way that they need to be translated. I think we all know as well that translating your skills from whatever you did in the military to make yourself marketable to a company that might not know much about the military is very, very difficult. And we all struggle with it. There's lots of resources out there. Mission Transition, we like to think, is a great one. And we welcome anybody who wants to try to check it out. And also interviewing. So interviewing is a great conversation, right? And we there's all kinds of advice and pointers about, you know, how to max out the interview. This is, we think, also a great resource to make sure that you, as a transitioning service member, can take those stories, right? Because it's all about storytelling and tell those stories in a way that somebody who may know nothing about the military can go like, oh yeah, okay, I get that. And now I can see why you might be a good fit within our organization. So again, this is free to anybody who would like to join. There is no requirement to log in or create an account. We just welcome you to use it. It's self-paced and, you know, there is no testing requirement or anything. We offer it as a resource and we hope that it's useful to the transitioning veteran community. Thanks, Rich.
Oh, that's great. I think I definitely could have used a tool like this when I was transitioning out. And I'm going to ask Brandon to throw that link in there to your careers page, which has that Mission Transition link as well, so that everyone has access to that. But no, I think that's great. You hit on a lot of the things that I think most transitioning service members struggle with when they're transitioning into. The more you can start looking at that stuff on your own, the better off you're going to be, because really the transition is an individual effort. You have to do some work, and I think that that is huge. So thank you, Home Depot, and thanks, Gabe, for giving us a little outline on that, and I encourage everybody to take a look at it. But now I wanted to also introduce the other two guests that we have on the screen here. As I mentioned, Erik and Pete. So Erik is a 5-time mentor now, I think. Is that right, Erik? Oh, 7-time mentor.
5 years, yeah. Eight mentors.
Wow. So he has been working with us for quite a while. as a mentor and has a pretty great career at Home Depot. And then we have Pete, who is a newly transitioned out service member who finished up this summer. And I'll ask him to tell us some more about his journey. He was also a protege at ACP and participated in some of the programs that they have there at Home Depot. So let's start with you, Erik. Why don't you just give us a little rundown on who you are and your career?
Yeah, absolutely. And again, thank you for the invitation and the time. So Erik Hodgin, I'm the Director of Freight Management here at the Home Depot in store operations. And what that means is in store operations, we're responsible for improving operational process, technologies, introducing new applications to improve the experience of our customers and our associates. And we do that on my team through all the product movement space. I've been with the company for 18 years, and coming to Home Depot, I'd finished up my undergraduate. I was doing some sales jobs and really had just landed initially at Home Depot in the stores in our contractor services department as something temporary, something to pay the bills, you know, keep the lights on while I look for my real job, right? But coming to Home Depot, really learned more about the company and fell in love with the values and the culture that we have and how the company really stands behind it. Now, how much emphasis we put on not just our customers, but our associates. And then also being a large company is there's a lot of opportunities. You're not necessarily just looking for the job. It's also the organization and the culture, right? So a large company like Home Depot dabbles in a little bit of everything. We have legal departments. We have real estate departments. We've got merchants that buy products. You've got transportation, logistics. I mean, you can run the full gambit. And so it gives, opens up a lot of doors and possibilities to grow long-term with the company. So I was in our stores for about 8 years doing several different roles and progressing, and then have been in the store operations space for about 10 in various different departments. And really, as I said earlier, have been participating in the ACP programs as a mentor for about 5 years. And now right in the middle of my eighth protege. So loving the opportunity.
Oh, that's great. You bring up so many things that are important for people to understand. I think I always use myself as an example. When I left the military, I did not have a very good understanding of what goes on at especially big companies, right? So my little mind was thinking, you know, if you asked me about Home Depot, the only thing I would be thinking about are the store clerks, right? And then as I've gotten to know a lot of our corporate partners, but Home Depot is amazing, and Gabe has continually educated me about what goes on in Home Depot. And there are so many different roles there in so many different areas, from, you know, IT to, like you mentioned, supply chain, project management, all these other operations and legal and finance. So getting to understand that's a part of corporate America and some of these companies is really good to know, because you may not even realize that there's a great job right there in your backyard that you might want to go to. So thank you for kind of giving that introduction. And it's kind of great to see that you've been able to start at the stores and work your way up. 18 years at Home Depot, that's something that doesn't happen that much anymore, unless that person feels that they really have a home and they feel like they're being taken care of at their company. So it's great. It says a lot about Home Depot as well. All right, Pete, tell us about yourself, how you got to Home Depot, but all the history behind that.
Thanks, Rich. So as you mentioned, my name is Brent Peterson. I do go by Pete. I am an Air Force veteran of almost 21 years. I was 5 days short of my 21-year mark, so I like to go ahead and round that up and take credit for that one. But I'm an aviation maintenance by trade. And so I've moved around the world, been to a lot of different bases, worked on C-17 airframe, RC-135s, KC-10 and KC-46 platforms. But transitioning out of that and out of the Air Force, I knew I didn't want to do aircraft maintenance anymore. And so when I'm looking for what's the next step, trying to find who is Pete outside of the military, ACP, I kind of stumbled upon ACP. And being quite frankly, I'd never heard of ACP until I started my transition. And I was introduced to the program and an opportunity to be a protege. And I said, hey, why not? So I reached out and I signed up. I enrolled to have a mentor assigned to me. And they assigned a man named Will Porter. And me and him, we hit it off. I saw his kind of like his resume, if you will. And he had experience in all aspects of what I was looking for. I wasn't exactly sure which path I wanted to take, but I knew project management, change management, something along those lines, continuous improvement. Those are things that I really enjoyed doing while I was serving. I wanted to do that aspect afterwards. So he walked me through different ways of getting there and different ways of approaching it, and helped me to really, like Gabe mentioned earlier, figure out how to translate my previous skills into what really matters and what will make myself stand out in the civilian market. So he helped me find Home Depot, essentially. I ended up interviewing with Home Depot when I was in my transitioning program. So when I was going through the DoD SkillBridge program, and they were the last company I did an interview with. And I immediately after interviewing with them, I knew they were my number one choice. And so I put them right to the top. Just even the initial interview, I could see, I could really put myself there. You know, you can see a lot of similarities, a lot of things line up, very military friendly organization. And just, I've always been kind of an avid DIY kind of person. So I could, you know, I felt like I could relate to their products and everything about them. So I ended up doing my fellowship, as you mentioned, last summer, with the digital finance team here as a project manager at the Home Depot. And while that initial position didn't work out, it opened the door to so many opportunities. And so like Erik mentioned, there's just so many different ways of networking and so many different paths you can go down, and the opportunities were endless at Home Depot. And I could really see from each and every person I reached out to just to connect with and do like a coffee chat and learn what they did in different parts of the business. Every single person welcomed me with open arms and was jumping at the opportunity to help me in any way they could. And you know, every person would point me to other people that could help me as well. And I could really see that kind of like that family bonding, if you will, for such a large scale organization. And I really saw the value in that. And so I kept going through their careers page and looking at the different opportunities that were out there and trying to see how I could fit those needs. And I was working with, like I said, my ACP mentor, Will, and figuring out how to twist and turn and tweak my previous experience so that I could show that I was capturing those needs. And a couple months later, I ended up getting hired in the .com space. So I'm an associate project manager in the IMSO organization. Like I said, it's the .com side of things where we work on robotic process automations that are work behind the scenes, building projects that support the website and all the items that are on it. And I started that back in February. So I've been with full time now for 8 months, and I love every minute of it.
Oh, that's great. You bring up so many things that I would imagine most people out there can relate to. First of all, kind of having a career in the military that you didn't want to turn around and do in the civilian world. So that is oftentimes the case. And sometimes even if you have the desire, there may not be a direct fit. So that's one thing that a lot of people deal with. And then this idea that, you know, you weren't exactly sure what you wanted to do. We have statistics that show like 86% of the people that leave the military don't know what they want to do. So working with your mentor to kind of, you know, figure that out was key. And then, you know, the culture you mentioned about Home Depot, I think that's something that is something you should always look for when you're looking for a new position, because that culture is going to make it whether you like going into work every day or whether you dread going to work every day. Sounds like Home Depot has really got it. So I'm going to kind of now go into some questions, but it made me think about asking Erik, when you have someone that comes to you as a protege and doesn't know what they want to do, how do you help them figure that out? Because I think this is something a lot of us struggle with and are, frankly, are anxious or concerned about, right? And sometimes maybe even embarrassed about. So how do you help protégés like that?
Yeah, absolutely. And I'll say it's nothing. It can definitely be embarrassing, or you're like, man, I should have figured this out. That is not something that's unique to military to civilian. And it's not something that is unique to, there's plenty of people on the floor right now who are trying to figure out what they, myself included, what I want to be when I grow up. Right. It's perfectly normal, but I think of it as really just asking a lot of questions and taking the time to really think about it. A lot of times we may gravitate toward, you know, something that's comfortable. So let's say you have a logistics background and you go, oh, I was a logistics manager in the military, so I'm going to look into logistics and supply chain. Well, the skills you have in logistics and the term logistics may mean something different in different organizations. So it's really kind of getting in there and going, all right, I had this job that had this title. Let's not worry about the title. Like, what were the actual activities that I was doing in that job that really brought me joy or that I could see myself doing? Was it leadership and development of teams? Was it, no, I like, you know, running a P&L and doing operational improvement? Or you're like, no, I like, you know, have a focus on the customer and enabling people to get the job done, like really keying into the things that you enjoy. And the reality is a lot of those skill sets and things can be applied to a lot of different positions. But I think really knowing like what you enjoy doing, less about the role and more about the activities, and what you don't like doing can really help you zero in on different organizations and different types of careers that you would be a good fit for. And ones that you go like, you know what, if I was doing that all day, every day for a long period of time, I might get burnt out.
Yeah. I'm going to ask Gabe, how did you figure out what you wanted to do?
What a great question. So for me, it was a little bit of trial and error. Like most people who transition out in the military, you struggle with what that next is going to be. When Pete was mentioning his own story, it resonated with me because Pete knew that for sure he wanted to do something different, right? He had these skills that he had grown up and acquired working in aviation maintenance, and he's very good at it. But he said, you know what, I might be very good at it, but I don't want to do that anymore. And it was similar for me. I was in the aviation business too. I loved it. I enjoyed it, but I didn't want to continue that as I transitioned. So for me, it was a matter of talking to my mentor to have similar conversations like the one that Erik just described, in which some hard questions were asked. And like, hey, let's write down skill sets. Let's write down things that you value. You know, like, for example, I value trust. I tend to be an optimist by nature, right? I value positive, you know, personal relationships. And that kind of helped me funnel my interests a little more and kind of narrow down my search. It's a very common thing I see with veterans as they transition, that they are very broad in their interests. And that can be good to begin with, but I always urge veterans to narrow down those interests because that's going to help them find that next. But for me, ultimately, it came to trial and error, right? I think it's always okay if you transition and you go into a new role. If you figure out that role is not a fit, it's okay to move on, right? It doesn't have to be another, you know, if you spent 20 years in the military, your next move does not have to be a 20-year move. If it is, then that's fantastic and I congratulate you for it. But, you know, I actually floated around a couple of different positions and I figured out kind of where my strengths lay. And I found that the veteran transition space was one that I was really interested in. And I was able to parlay some of my volunteer work in this space into a full-time position. And that's how I arrived to where I am today.
Right. And so Pete, was there anything else that you did to with your mentor to figure out where you ultimately wanted to land?
Yeah, Gabe hit on a couple of them. Really just identifying your strengths, and not just your strengths, but things that you really enjoyed to do. So it might not necessarily be a strength. It might be a weakness area, but if it's something that you enjoy doing and you want to get better at it, then that's an area that you want to go towards. So we did a lot of the exact same thing where you're kind of writing it down, almost like an old school, like pros and cons list. And you're just writing everything down and targeting down, like pinpointing a specific field or a specific area. And for me, it was project management. I didn't know what space in project management. As you probably know, you can be a project manager in just about any field there is, right? And so when I was going through their careers page, I was looking at all the different options, all the different departments that they had open positions. And quite frankly, I had to Google some of the words in the position that I hold, because I'd never heard of them. I didn't know what they meant. For instance, RPA, I'd never heard the term RPA, robotic process automation. I don't have a tech background. I don't have a computer background, but it interested me. I'm like, oh, okay. Well, if it interests me, then that might be something worth pursuing. And so I started looking into it more and more and more. And then I reached out and I was put in contact with people in this department. And then I eventually talked to the manager of the team that I'm with. And I really got to understand and know, like, the day-to-day, like Erik was saying, your title doesn't really matter. It's what you're really doing on a day-to-day basis that matters. I found it really intriguing and something I'd never really done. I didn't have any experience, but I was interested in learning. And so it's been a learning experience. I've been learning new skills almost every single day since I joined, and I'm going to continue down that path.
I think you bring up some great points. This idea of kind of doing your research and networking, those are huge. And I think it also, again, helps you find the right place the first time rather than, experimenting as much, because you have a little bit of that background. And so, Erik, when you have a protege that is looking to, looking at different positions and all, how do you help them, or what skills do you tell them to capitalize on from their military career that they might not believe matters, right? I've heard oftentimes people be like, I was just a squad leader, or I was just a gunner, or whatever else. But, what do you say to someone when they say something like that?
Yeah, I mean, everybody has a vast array of life experiences, career experiences, and different things. And a lot of times it's kind of a quest to translate that into what that word means in application in different roles. And sometimes the terminologies, you can get mixed up. I mean, I like to think is some fields of interest require very specific degrees and very specific training, but lots of fields don't. And so it's really that experience. So a lot of the protégés that I meet with, it's like, hey, tell me a little bit of what you can, right? About your position, like what kinds of things you did. I'll use an example. We had a protégé who was in logistics. And so initially they were looking for logistics and transportation roles. And when you talk more with the individual, it was a lot of leadership. It was a lot of management. There was some, planning and forecasting involved. There was general maintenance. And you start pulling apart those different skills and you're like, gosh, you're only applying to jobs that say logistics and transportation. But what you're describing to me is you could run a distribution center or a warehouse as like a general manager or a director of that facility. Like you could, and you take that same skill set, that's just management and running a logistics facility, but that could be any kind of business or organization or role where you're having to manage things and get projects done on timelines and things like that. So it's really peeling off those skills. And then from like an application resume process, it's how do you tease those out to apply to the role that, you're interested in?
No, I think that's great advice. And I think, I can't overestimate or overemphasize the amount of goodness you get from having a mentor, because part of it is just having that one-on-one time where you have to cut everything else out of your life for that 30 minutes or an hour. And you have kind of someone else's undivided attention during that time, and they can ask those questions, and you could actually think about how you would answer them and how to, work through some of the scenarios that you've done and how they can apply. So it's huge having a mentor to help with that. Pete, you used other resources when you were transitioning. I know you were ACP protege, but you also use some other resources. So can you talk through what you use and how, you benefited from them?
Sure. So ACP was by far my largest resource that I use, being quite frank.
We didn't pay him to say that.
I'm sorry?
I said, we didn't pay you to say that.
Oh, no. mainly because of how everything worked out. I had an assigned caseworker that reached out, touched base with me every couple of weeks, made sure everything was good to go. I hit it off with my mentor, Will, and things couldn't have gone better that way. Outside of that, most of it was really me and talking to other people that have gone through similar experiences and other resources that when you're going through the SkillBridge program, they put you in touch with a lot of different people, like Vets to PM and these different organizations and things like that. But quite honestly, ACP was my favorite and that was my go-to. So I stayed in most contact with them and I have completed the mentorship program, but I still can't stay in contact with my mentor, Will. In fact, I have a one-on-one with him tomorrow afternoon, just kind of keeping tabs on him. He's keeping tabs on me and keeping that connection alive and always helping with what's next. So.
Great. And so Gabe, can you elaborate on some of the particular kind of pathways and additional tools that Home Depot has for veterans?
Certainly. So for those interested in joining the Home Depot, we are a DoD SkillBridge partner. So for those who are looking to look at a path towards our company, it's something that we do together with Hiring Our Heroes, right? So you can sign up through them or you can sign up directly through our own portal and you'll find that as well in the same Military Careers portal. We, as Erik described, we are a company with many, many teams that do many, many things. So whether it's cyber, whether it's logistics, whether it's, you know, data analytics, you know, project management and, you know, planning for the in-store environment, so many things, or whether it's working towards a leadership position within our store, we got you, right? And just this morning, I was actually speaking to a number of teams within the Home Depot to promote our SkillBridge program, to tell them, to ask them to sign up for hosting fellows. And a lot of them were super interested because they know the talent and the value that veterans bring to our company. Now, one of the things I like about the company too, is that within the Home Depot, your path can be as varied as you want it to be. When we were in the military, we got used to a rhythm that every 2 or 3 years, we get a new job. And many of us said, wait, I was just now getting good at this. And you're telling me I have to go do something else? You know, what's up with that? Well, in the end, we figured it out because our leaders trusted us and we got that tap on the shoulder and they said, you know, Pete, you're doing pretty well here. I think you can do some pretty good work in this new place I'm going to send you. And maybe at first we were a little flummoxed, right? But we were thrown in the deep end and we figured it out. Home Depot, I find, is the same way. It's great opportunities to go do something entirely new within the business that you maybe haven't touched before, but everybody gives you that sense of confidence to do it. You get a lot of help along the way and you wind up adding value. And we have found that that's a great model to create very well-rounded individuals within the company so they can themselves grow and learn about the many things that we do. So for veterans to grow within this environment, I think is a very natural fit and something that they'll find is it works pretty well based on previous experiences.
And so we've been talking mostly about veterans, but can you talk about opportunities or things that a military spouse might consider if they were thinking about Home Depot as a place of employment?
Certainly. Yeah. We have over 5,000 remote positions available at the Home Depot. So I realize that remote positions are favored by many people out there, many job seekers. I know military spouses in particular are interested in remote positions because of the nature of their environment. You know, they have a military spouse, they move every couple of years. And I know many of them wind up having to give up pretty good roles because of those moves. So to support that, we actually have a military transfer policy in which if our military spouses working at our stores get transferred because their spouses are getting transferred somewhere else, we will match them with a new position at the same level in their new location. We have the advantage of having a national footprint. So about 75 to 78% of our stores are within commuting distance of military installations, right? So it makes it a little easier to be able to find that role for a spouse if, you know, maybe finds herself or himself, you know, in a new position and having to say, now what am I going to do about that job? On top of that, we have an overseas leave of absence option so that if a spouse goes overseas to accompany their military member, we, for up to 5 years, we will hold that position, or I shouldn't say hold, but ensure they have a position similar to that one when they return. And that doesn't have to be in the same location from where they left. It can be at a new location. So if you're stationed in San Diego, for example, and you get sent overseas to Japan, but after that you come back to the Northern Virginia area, or, you know, wherever, we will work with our team to make sure that that military spouse is taken care of. So we are a partner of the Military Spouse Employment Partnership, which is a DOD initiative that many people here on this call probably know. And we're very proud to say that we work to try to bring as many military spouses as we can to the company.
Oh, that's really what really thought through. We really appreciate it. I even saw Pete like, wow, I didn't know that.
I didn't. I was going to chime in. I honestly didn't know. I'm that much more proud to work for Home Depot now.
Yeah.
Great. We can talk later, Pete.
No, that was great. So there are a few questions in the chat, and I want to remind anybody, if they have questions, to throw them in the chat. But a lot of people understand about the skill bridge, but they have time frames and numbers of slots and all that type of stuff. So what happens if someone either doesn't get a skill bridge or they miss the timing? Are there other kind of internship opportunities, or what do you recommend to someone that missed the opportunity?
Yeah, there are a couple of options available for transitioning service members, right, who might not fit the skill bridge window for whatever reason. Number one is they can apply for a direct hire, right? And we do have open positions that we look to hire directly all the time. And these are, whether it's in our stores, right, or whether it's working for our store support center, which is our headquarters in Atlanta, we do have a number of positions available there. On top of that, we have opportunities for service members to take a look at as they transition, so that they can use our, whether it's using our mission transition skill set, right, or contacting us, and I can share the email here with you here in a little bit, which is it's veteran_recruiting@homedepot.com. Again, veteran_recruiting@homedepot.com. And we encourage veterans to let us know if they find a role within the Home Depot website, and we can help them track their application. Because often in big companies, it's, you know, you feel like you send your application that gets lost in the void and you never hear back, right? We are a big company. We do use an applicant tracking system, but we try to do our best to help veterans as they apply by letting them know whether they're competitive for a particular role. So those are things that we urge veterans to apply for. On top of that, if we have a transitioning service member or a military spouse who is a full-time student to get a college degree, we have a number of internships that are geared towards degree-seeking people, veterans and others. So they qualify for some of our internships by virtue of also being a student. And that's something that we also encourage our job seekers to check out. And that's also to be found in our careers page. You just type internship and the internships will pop up.
No, that's great. Thank you. So I do have a question, another question that says, what are your recommendations for veterans who live in a rural area, maybe too far from commuting to a brick and mortar location, but would prefer in person?
If they are too far to commute, but they would still prefer in-person roles, maybe we recommend a part-time route, right? If it's something that they want to pursue part-time, we have a number of roles available part-time in our stores. I have spoken to many leaders within our company. Erik, I'm sure, has spoken to many more who began as part-time associates in our stores, who then found that they enjoyed it and that it was rewarding. And you know what? They were good at it. And they got promoted and they transitioned over to full-time roles, and they continue to grow within the company. So for people who might be living a little too far to commute to a brick and mortar location, you know, if they still want that in-person experience, maybe the right thing to do is to try to find that balance. And I think the part-time route might be the most appropriate one. Right. I don't know if Erik might have anything to add on that, but that's kind of my take on that.
Yeah, no, absolutely.
I actually answered a question that I went past and just scrolled back to, that someone was asking about using a part-time role to build some skills as they're waiting to, you know, get into the full-time role. So that's great. We answered that one as well. So it looks like we got a lot of the questions answered, but I want to go back to everyone on the panel and just kind of ask you, Erik, what's the best part about working at Home Depot?
The best part about working for for Home Depot is one, knowing that it's with a group of associates and a company that really does care for not only each other, but our communities. If you think about how we respond during disasters and things of that nature, so it's very rewarding. And in my personal space and operations, it's rewarding that I get to give back to the associates in the store in a meaningful way that improves their lives.
Great. Pete, what about you? What's the best part of working at Home Depot?
Well, honestly, I have several things. Erik just hit on part of it. To me, it's the closest thing I could possibly see to like a large scale family. So anybody that's, you know, served in the military has probably been overseas at some point. You know, there's a difference between an overseas location and a stateside location, and that when you go overseas, your comrades, your battle buddies, your whatever you want to call them, they really are your family. So they open you with welcome arms. They'll give you their, you know, the skin on their back. They'll give you anything they can do. In Home Depot, I felt the exact same way since day one arriving here. Everyone wants to help everybody. Everybody will do anything they possibly can to connect you with somebody else. If they can't help you, they'll find somebody that can help you. It's basically just like when you go to a store and you see somebody wearing the apron, and you immediately walk to them. They're willing to walk you anywhere through the store to find a product that you're looking for, point you in the right direction. It's the same way through the whole corporation. And I kind of wanted to touch on that previous question, the person that asked about a rural environment. I live in a rural environment. I live on an island. And so the closest store, I remember going through onboarding, they said there's a Home Depot store within like 10 minutes of 92% of Americans, or some stat like that. I'm the other 88%. And so the closest Home Depot is almost an hour away from me. But they still find a way to make you feel like you're there. And so even the remote positions, I'm doing things like this all day, every day, working through Microsoft Teams. I'm doing web connections, and I'm on camera with people. And just the fact that people are always there wanting to help. They share a lot of the same values that service members have. So all the branches have some sort of core values, you know, beliefs that they hold true to. And Home Depot is no different. They do the exact same thing, and they live by them all day, every day. So,
great. Gabe, what about you? What's the best part?
I agree with everything that Pete and Erik said. For me, it also comes down to two particular things. Number one is leadership. Number one is growth opportunities. During my time in the Navy, spent 25 years on active duty, I had some fantastic leaders. And I think anybody who's been in the military will say, I had some pretty good leaders. I had some maybe not so great leaders. But walking out of the military, you know, I came away having worked for some fantastic leaders. And my expectation level of leadership was pretty high. And Home Depot met that head on and has exceeded it. And from my day one, I've interacted with a bunch of leaders here at the company that are fantastic people, and that really has impressed upon me something that I've already known, which is that leadership matters. And to be able to interact with people like that, who live our values, as Pete was saying, and who are happy to help with anything you need, it really gets me inspired to be part of this team. The other part is growth. Because we are such a large organization, as I was describing a few minutes ago, you know, you get opportunities to go to different places in the company. You have very sincere conversations with leaders on a regular basis about your own career development. You know, I would think that it'd be very easy for you to be hired and then kind of forgotten about, and that's just not the case here. So for me to have conversations with my leaders in which we sit down and say, hey, Gabe, you know, what are you thinking about what you want to do next within the company? I'm like, whoa, hey, what's the hurry here? You know, I'm cool doing what I'm doing. But it's like, yeah, we know you're cool doing what you're doing, but we want you to think about what might be next. And to be able to get that kind of feedback on your performance, as well as options on what to pursue and ideas really on what to pursue next, is invaluable and something I've come to appreciate quite a bit about working at the Home Depot.
Yeah, and I'll just say from my perspective, it's not a given that every organization has great leaders. So you're very lucky to have those at Home Depot. There was one question that came in. I think this is a little bit complicated, but I think Gabe can answer it. There's a person that was approved for an off-cycle skill bridge fellowship through Hiring Our Heroes. And they were wondering if they were to apply for a direct hire position, can the hiring manager kind of code that for a fellowship?
Yeah, I see that question. Unfortunately, we cannot do that because at the Home Depot, SkillBridge fellows are not guaranteed a position at the end of that fellowship. We do have a high placement rate of about 70%. So the vast majority of our fellows are a cultural fit and wind up being hired full time. That said, if you apply for a position as a direct hire, that happens outside the scope of our SkillBridge fellowship program, and our fellowships are not coded as full-time positions. So that is almost like two different buckets of roles. So we're unfortunately unable to do that.
Well, that's good to know. I wanted to ask a question because I don't know how that stuff works. So I appreciate the education there. Well, gentlemen, thank you so much for all the great information you gave us. Again, every time I hear about the Home Depot, I think that it sounds like a great place to work. So I really appreciate you all and your partnership with ACP and sharing your experiences. And as we close out, I wanted to ask everyone out there, you know, to support ACP in any way you can. So sign up to be a protege or a mentor, refer a friend, introduce ACP to a company, or make donations on our website. So we appreciate your support, and we strive to help as many members in the military community as we can. So thank you. And have a great rest of the day.
Thank you, Rich. Thank you, ACP.
Take care.